Thanks, Joe. So everybody hears me clearly? Okay. So the talk, my talk today will be about geo-distributed storage systems. So why do we care so much about geo-distributed storage systems? It's because that nowadays we have so many large web applications, such as Google+, Facebook, Twitter, and eBay service, that they are all built on such a storage system. So by distributing data across many data centers, we could put data near user, so we can ensure fast access from the user. And also, by replication, we can let the applications tolerate the failure of a whole data center. So geo-distribution is a hard problem because we have this difficult trade-off between low latency and strong semantics. Here, by low latency, I mean that applications demand fast access time, and so that users could have a good experience. So ideally, we would like to make sure that applications only issue issue requests to local data center. And by strong semantics, I mean that programmers need to have some easy-to-use programming support, such as relational tables and transaction support. So it's very difficult to find a point between those two trade-offs. And now let's see what's the trade-off point available. So I'm showing the systems along two dimensions. On the horizontal axis, we differentiate the systems that provide general transaction support to those that only provide key-value storage support. And on the vertical axis, I'm showing the consistent level of the storage system, the weakest one being eventual consistency, and the stronger ones are serializable and strict serializable. Hereby, serializable, I mean that for all the operations inside of the system, there is a total global order. And the strict serializable is stronger than that because it has some restrictions on that total ordering. So we know that it's easy to build an eventual consistent key-value storage system. And we have Dynamo as an example. And thanks to CAP's theorem, we know that in order to achieve strict serializability, one have to pay the price of high latency. And we know that we have that Google's Spanner storage system, which provides general transaction support, and also it provides strict serializability. So it sits on top the top right corner of this landscape. And during the past few years, researchers have been pushing the boundary of low latency system to the top right corner. And so now we have a system that provides semantics that is stronger than eventual consistency, and we have systems that provide a limited form of transaction, like read-only and write-only transactions. But we still have this gray area, which means that we don't know if we can provide transactions that are serializable and only have low latency. So our work is to push this boundary even further. And we show that on the most situations, it's possible to achieve serializable transaction at low latency. So in pushing the boundary further, we made two contributions that first, we propose a new programming primitive called a transaction chain. And it is the key to provide provide serializable transactions at low latency. And another contribution is that we built the links, a storage system called the links that is that supports relational tables and secondary indices and materialized join views. And all its functionality is based on this chain primitive. So I've given you the overview of our contribution. So now I will dive into details of our system. I will first introduce the transaction chain primitive to you, and I will show how we use this primitive to build our links storage system. And finally, I will give you the performance number of our system. So to motivate why we need something like transaction chain, we look at this auction service example. So in this application, we have two tables, the bids table as painted in pink, and the item table painted in yellow. So the bids table has three columns, the bidder information, the item being bid on, and the price of that bid. And for the item table, we have the seller information, we have the item being sold, and the currently the highest price on that item. So the bids table is sharded according to the bidder column and distributed across data centers. And item table is sharded according to the seller column. So we could have this final configuration that Alice's data is put into data center one, which is closer to her, and Bob's data is put into data center two, closer to him. So now let's look at this example operation that Alice puts a bid onto Bob's camera. And this operation involves two steps. So first, we need to insert a bid request into Alice's bid shard. And secondly, we need to update the highest price on Bob's camera. So the auction service logic would like to execute those two steps in one transaction. But unfortunately, the data that is being accessed locates in two data centers. So the resulting transaction will be a distributed transaction, and that will have a high latency. So we want to avoid that. And it would be nice if we can chop up the transaction into two parts. The first part updating Alice's data, and the second part updating Bob's data. So this chopped up transaction represents a chain that each hop of the chain updates data in one data center. And the hops are executed serially one after each another. This chain primitive gives us the benefit that we could allow applications to return after the first hop instead of waiting for the whole chain to finish. So let's look at this example, how Alice put the bid on Bob's camera. So Alice issued a bid onto Bob's camera, and that request will be turned into a chain of two hops. First hop updating Alice's data, and second hop updating Bob's data. The first hop will only access data that's located into a local data center. So it could be carried out immediately, and a response can be sent back to Alice. So Alice can move on to her next operations. Well, in the background, the second hop is shipped into Bob's data center and updated the price on Bob's camera. So we can see that this chain primitive gave us the benefit to ensure low latency. But actually, it has a few problems. So the first problem is, what if a chain fails in the middle? We got two dangers here. So if a server fails after executing part of the chain, then we could lose that part of the chain. So the storage system will be left in an inconsistent storage state, and that is bad. The second problem is that a user could abort a chain in the middle. So in that case, some of the uncommitted data could have been already leaked to other chains. And in that case, we don't have a proper way to roll back this situation. So our solution to this problem is that we provide all-or-nothing atomicity for chains. And this is implemented using reliable logging. So upon committing the first hop of a chain, we write a log into a reliable log service. And that log is replicated to a nearby data center. So it's very fast because it's nearby. So upon recovery, we can detect such stored chains, and we can re-execute them. So the storage state will be moved to a consistent status. And the second limitation we put on, and the second mechanism is that we only allow users to abort in the first hop. So this will get rid of the second danger we talked before. And with those two mechanisms, we can guarantee that if the first hop of a chain commits, then all the other hops will eventually commit. So that's how we deliver this all-or-nothing atomicity for chains. And another danger is that chains could allow non-serializable interleaving when it is being executed. So let's see this example. So we got two transactions, T1 and T2, going on, and they both modify variable X and Y. And they could have this final execution order. So we can see that on the storage server, which stores variable X, we have transaction T1 ordered before T2. But on the storage server of Y, we could have T1 ordered after T2, which is a contradiction, and thus this execution order is not serializable. And the traditional way to address this issue is to use something like two-phase locking and the two-phase commit. But that has high latency, so we want to avoid that. Now we have this observation that for web applications, we actually know all the actions beforehand. So we could leverage some static analysis techniques to deal with this situation. We could detect all the non-serializable interleavings and actively prevent them from executing. So again, look at the example I gave you before. So our static analysis is based on transaction chopping theory from database literature, and this is how it works. For the example I gave you before, we connect hops from the same chain using blue edge, and this is called an S edge. And then we detect all the pairs of hop across two chains and see if there is a conflict. Here by conflict, I mean for two hops, they access the same data, and one of the requests is, at least one of them is a write request. So we connect the conflicting hop pairs with a red edge, which is called a C edge, representing the conflict. And now we look at this final graph, and we check if there is a cycle inside the graph, which contains both blue and red edges. And this kind of a cycle is called SC cycle. And it is proved that the chains are serializable if we don't have such SC cycles. And we also have a few techniques to deal with the situation that when we have SC cycles. And I will talk about that in a few slides later. So now let's look at how we build Links storage system using this chain primitive. Links provides relational tables and a bunch of functionalities, which is based on this chain primitive. And inside the links, we provide two kinds of chains. The first is called user chain, which is used by developers to implement the application logic. And the second kind of chain is called a system chain, which is used by links internally and to maintain its functionality, like secondary indices and materialized join views, and also for geo-replication. Now let's look at one of the system chain in action. We look at the secondary index example. So again, let's get back to our auction service example. And this could be the, how the data is sharded across data centers. Remember that we have a bid table, which is sharded, indexed and sharded according to the bidder column. So suppose we want to add a secondary index on this table, which contains the same data, but is indexed and sharded according to a different column, say item column, and let this be how the data gets sharded across two data centers. So to maintain those two tables, we want to make sure that those two tables have the same data. So whenever we update the base table, we have to use a system chain to also update the secondary table to ensure they contain the same data. And now let's see how the user chains and the system chain work together. So the auction action example is actually a perfect example for user chains. When Alice put a bid on Bob's camera, the system will generate a user chain which contains two steps. The first step is updating is to insert it into Alice's bid table. Please note that since we have a secondary index on the bids table, the first hop will be automatically expanded to include a subchain, which is a system chain that first inserts into the base bids table, and then it will insert into the secondary index of the bids table. So this animation shows how the hops are carried out one by one in different data centers. Now let's look at how Links provides, make sure that we have serializability for the chains. To simplify things, we only consider two operations. One is put bid operation, as I given you before, and the other one is read bids operation, which reads from a user's local bid table to see his or her bidding activity. So Links, when doing static analysis, it will generate two copies of the same chain. This is because we want to, we could have multiple running instances of the same chain in the system, and we want to detect self-conflict of the same chain, from the same chain. So we need two copies of the chain. And let's add the conflicting edges here. So you can see we got an SC cycle here. And to make sure that chains can be executed serializably, so one solution to do that is we have to run those chains as a distributed transaction. But we want to avoid that because it has high latency. So now the problem is that we have to deal with this SC cycle situation. And so we need to think about where does those SC cycle come from. The first possibility is that we got a false conflict. And the second possibility is that we got a real conflict situation, and we need to deal with that. Now let's look at the example, the SC cycle example before. If we look at the second hop closely, we can see that it's actually a false conflict, because When updating the item table, we are actually using the max function to update the highest bid. And we know that max is a commutative operation. So this conflict on the second hop is actually not a big deal. So the solution we give to programmers is that we let users annotate such kind of commutativity operations. So if users mark that second hop as commutative to itself, we can see that the SSH cycle is gone, and we can safely execute the chain serializably. So in the example I gave you before, when we are doing SSH analysis, we are not actually 100% correct, because we only consider the user chains. To make things correct, we have to also consider the system chains. So if we expand the first hop and include the system chains, we can find that we also got an SSH cycle among those system chains. So unlike the user chain example I gave you before, this is actually a true conflict, because executing the hops in different order in different data centers, we will get diverged storage status. So we have to deal with this situation. So our solution is that we have this observation that conflicting system chains modify the same variable, so they must start from the same first hop server. So we can expand the chain property to guarantee first origin ordering, which means that if chain T1 starts before T2 at the first hop, then in all the later hops, we can guarantee that order to ensure that T1 executes before T2. And this could be cheaply implemented using sequence number vectors. So if we can base that order on all the later hops, then we can remove the conflict in all the later hops, and we only have conflict on the first hop, which can help us to reduce most of the SSH cycles. Now, I have to address a few limitations of our Linux storage system. It's the first thing is that chains only provide serializability guarantees. It's not strictly serializable. So under some situations, you might get unexpected ordering of transactions, and the developers have to work around that. And the second thing is programmers can only abort in the first step. So when writing some transactions, developers have to use some techniques to work around this. But in our experience, we think those two limitations are not that, it's not a big problem. We can still write many useful applications and to adapt to those limitations. So now let's look at the evaluation number of our system. We are evaluating our system using this simple Twitter clone system application, sorry. So we got two tables in this system. The tweet table has all stores all the tweets from the user. And we have the follow graph, which stores the information of who follows whom. We also have a bunch of secondary tables inside this system. So we have a secondary index on the follow graph, so that by querying this table, we can quickly enumerate a certain user's followers. So we can see that Bob can query this table and see that Alice and Clark is following him. And we also have a join view on the tweets table and the follow graph table. So this join view actually gave us the timeline information. So for example, if Alice wants to show her timeline, she can just query this table, and she can quickly get all the tweets from the users that she follows. And also, to make the system robust, we do geo-replication on the two base tables. We geo-replicate the tweets table and the follow graph table. We conduct our experiment on Amazon EC2, and in each data center, we have four storage servers and four clients talking to them. And we carry out the experiment on three data centers in West Coast, East Coast, and Europe. The latency across those data centers is around 100 milliseconds. And please note that for our Linux prototype, we store data in memory, and we log only to local disk only. Here is our latency numbers. And the first two bars in this chart shows the chain finish time. That is how long it takes for a whole chain to finish. We can see that, so for follow user operation, it's actually a chain of three hops, so it incurs two cross data center latency. And for post tweet user, for post tweet operation, the second step, the third step will spawn multiple hops to many data centers, and we need to wait for so we need to wait for all of them to finish. So that means we will incur the largest cross data center latency. So this is the reason why post tweet operation has higher chain finish time than follow user operation. But luckily, for our Twitter application, we don't need to wait for the whole chain to finish. We only need to wait for the first hop to finish. So that makes sure. So in that way, we can finish the operation within just a few milliseconds. And for the read timeline operation, it's just a local data center request with only one hop, so it also has very low latency. And besides low latency, our system also provides good throughput values. We can see that follow user operation and post tweet operation can achieve hundreds of thousands operations per second. And for read timeline operation, we can even achieve 1.3 million requests per second. And Lynx is built upon, inspired by a bunch of research projects. So we learned from transaction decomposition and incremental view maintenance. And we put the technique into a distributed setting, and we built a practical system to test those techniques. And we also learned from a bunch of distributed storage systems to make our system more have more functionality. So in conclusion, I have showed you that how chains can support serializability and low latency. And we have used static analysis of SA cycles to ensure serializability. And we also introduced a few techniques to help us with static analysis. And our experience of building the Lynx system and application suggests that this chain primitive is practical and very useful. So that concludes my talk, and I'm happy to take questions. Thanks. Thanks.
For timestamps, and there were also protocols like Barbara Liskov and Rivka Ladin's I forget what they called it, but it was kind of a ticket, and they used it for causality across separated replicated data stores. This was a SOSP paper probably back in the early 90s. And I wonder if you thought about that kind of prior work, because it points to an issue that we all used to run into that you didn't talk about, which is the need to provide a form of flow control, because you can otherwise get a situation where the primaries get so far ahead of the secondaries that a sort of an infinite backlog starts to form, and the system performance becomes very bursty. So typically, these systems have needed a flow control mechanism, and I'm surprised that you weren't talking about that.
So for our system, we don't think we have that problem, because whenever we update the primary copy, we also will immediately issue this chain to update the secondary copy, so we can make sure that they're not that far behind.
I'm astonished that at 1.3 million transactions a second, you think you won't be able to have that type of burst problem. But maybe you don't have enough experience yet.
Yeah, 1.3 million, I think that's reasonable, because we are reading from local data center, because we have that in local data center. We have that data in local data center. And for each request, that's about 60 bytes in total. So, well.
No, I understand that you can get that performance. I'm saying
no follow-ups.
Okay.
Hi, Nicolas Chipert, Cornell. So is it correct to say that because of the origin ordering that you use to avoid SC cycles,
yeah,
if the user happens to be the wrong data center, he or she will incur a wide area round trip for the first read operation, for instance?
Okay, thanks. That's a good question. So we have to ensure that our system give you the benefit of low latency. We wish that applications make sure all the requests of a certain user starts from the same data center that stores the user's data. I think this is reasonable because for most web applications, the user's data is actually sharded into a particular data center. And it's reasonable to start all the operations of that user from that data center.
If the user is somewhere else?
Well, if the user is somewhere else, then, well, unfortunately, you have to issue a long distance request, and that will be slow.
Okay. Thanks.
Let's do a question from the internet. Lynx statically analyzes all chains beforehand, but how does it have access to all transactions from many different data centers? Does this not introduce high latency?
Well, actually, the chains in the system is known beforehand, so we could do static analysis for that. We don't need to introduce high latency, I don't think so.
Marek Zawirski, Inria. So you gave a number of interesting techniques to avoid SC cycles in a graph.
Yeah.
So I wonder about those cases where the cycle is unavoidable. Which set of transactions needs to run as a distributed transaction?
Well, that's to be decided by the user. So in order to avoid the SC cycle, users have to try a few ways to, he has to select a few transactions and run that in a distributed transaction and see if that helps to avoid the SC cycle. We currently don't support automatically shrinking the dealing with this situation.
Thanks.
Phil Bernstein, Microsoft. You said that after the first segment of your chain, the application can't abort unilaterally. So what do I do if in later steps of the chain my transaction hits a state that makes it unable to finish? I mean, do I have to explicitly write code to back out my updates?
Yeah, unfortunately, this is currently a limitation for in our system. We're actually finding a way to support aborting in the later hops, and we currently don't have a good solution to that. So I think, unfortunately, developers have to deal with this situation. Sorry.
Mark Lowbridge, HP Labs. What isolation level do you actually support?
So we support serializability so that each transaction...
No. I'm pretty sure you don't support serializability as an isolation level. But that's perfect. That's full ACID.
Yeah, so the application, those transactions will appear to be atomic so that the intermediate data will not be leaked to other transactions.
What's the difference between serializability and strict serializability, which is not a defined isolation level?
Well, so strict serializability means that if two transactions, the first transaction finish before the second one starts, then this order will be preserved in all the data centers. But we only guarantee serializability, so it could be that the two transactions will get the order will be inverted.
Okay, thank you.